Good morning. Grace and peace be to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And welcome to Round Hill United Methodist Church on this beautiful day of worship. I hope you are enjoying the beautiful snow that we have had this week. If you are not a snow person, know that this coming week it'll be wonderful hot weather. So whatever you like, you are getting it in the past week or so. So it's a wonderful time to celebrate in the beauty of God's creation. And I'm glad that you can be here today or that you can join us online if you are joining us online. If you are with us online, wherever you may be, a couple of things to just note. The comment section allows you to stay connected wherever you might be joining us from. Not only are you able to contact one another, but you'll also be able to talk to us through that comment section. Particularly later in the service, when we lift up our joys and our concerns, you can send in those prayer concerns and joys, and we'll be able to see them, receive them, and share them with the entire congregation. So it's a wonderful way to stay connected through the wonders of technology and to be really the body of Christ. And so we're glad that you can join us as well. Today, we are going to be reading from our lectionary scripture in Mark, which is talking about the calling of the disciples as they have as they were fishing. And it might be interesting to think about fishing right now as we have snow all around us. But my friends from Minnesota might think that that's also just normal to fish in the snow. But we'll be talking about fishing and fishing for men, as the scripture talks about, and what that means for us as Christians today. So I'm glad that you can join us for this time. But as we gather, let us go first to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we give you thanks for the beauty of creation around us. We give you thanks that we can be here, whether here is in this sanctuary or here is present with you from wherever we are joining through the power of your Holy Spirit. Help us in this time together to be in a moment of reception for where it is that you are leading us. Have your Spirit stir within us as we hear your word proclaimed, as we join together in song, as we lift up prayers as one body, and as we gather around your table. Lord, in all that we do, let this be a time of praise to you, for you are worthy of that praise. And all this we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. At this time, as we continue in this time of preparing our hearts for praise, I invite us to join in singing our first song. It is in the Black Hymnal. It's called The Cry of My Heart. The words are also on the screen. It's 2165, and I invite us to stand as we are able as we sing our first song.
Teach me your holy ways, O Lord, and your way devoted.
may be seated. Our scripture lesson for this morning comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verses 16 through 20. As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with their hired men and followed him. The word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. At this time, I invite any children that would like to come forward for a children's message can come at this time. That's awesome. I love that. Okay, you'll have to tell me about it after worship, okay?
And then my dad, I can show you all the time.
Sounds great. Even better. I have a question for all of you, though.
Yeah?
Have any of you ever been fishing before?
No.
No, I know. We got to work on that. So some of you and some of you not. So I want to tell you the story of my first time fishing when I was a little kid. So I have an older sister, and I was even littler than her, but she was still pretty little. And we went with my aunt. And she took us fishing, and as we were going, we were starting to get everything ready, and we had the worms ready for the bait.
Did you eat the
fish? We did not eat the fish, but we had the worms ready for the bait, and as my aunt was getting everything ready, we turned around, and you know what my sister did? She dumped out the whole bucket of worms trying to free them because she didn't want the worms to be killed. Isn't that silly? And you know what's even funnier? I got sad when we actually caught a fish because the hook got caught in it, right? And so I got sad and I actually started crying when I was a little kid fishing. So our fishing experience when we were little kids was not the best, but I then learned to enjoy it. How many of you have enjoyed fishing before? Yeah? I know. It's kind of boring while you wait. So I was going to ask you about that because in our scripture today, Jesus talks about fishing. He's actually talking to some fishermen, and he says, "Stop fishing, and I'm going to have you fish for people."
They're wondering where the fish are.
Uh-huh. Let's not do that. So. Yes, is that what you think he means when he says cast for fish for people?
I know that's not it, but that's the real language.
It means that you can catch the fish when you guys do it for good.
Oh, so you have to give it to people. That's an interesting way of reading it. We'll catch and release, okay. Yeah Logan? What do you think
so
it means?
Catch for other people means you go with other people that don't have any food and you go, and if they don't know how to do anything, you get it for them.
Yeah, so
basically what I said.
So the two of you are thinking it's about caring for others and fishing and giving it to people that need. Jesus would definitely agree with that. But part of what Jesus is saying is the same way that you fish for people, or the same that way you fish for fish, you need to go and kind of try to bring people to God. Now, like you said, is it always exciting when you're fishing?
No.
Right. So do you think it's always exciting to try to share about God or bring people to God?
Yes.
Not always. Sometimes it could be really boring or not something's not always happening all the time. Yes. You know, that moment's not always there. You're just waiting. But then that moment comes. And what happens when that moment comes? What do you need to do?
You need to
grab it. You got to take advantage of that moment and share the good news, right?
I don't know how to make fishing for people exciting.
How do you make fishing for people exciting?
Gummy worms.
I'm loving the gummy worms approach. I think everybody would love the gummy worms approach. And so... We're really thinking through this gummy worm approach. But the real thing to think through is the idea that when we are trying to bring people to God and help to share the good news about God, is that it's not always going to be happening right in front of us all the time. But when that moment comes, like when that moment comes that the fish bites, we have to be ready. We have to be prepared to take advantage of that moment to share about why we love Jesus. And so will you join me in a word of prayer? Let's pray. God, we give you thanks that you call us to be fishers of people. And we know that means for us to go and to share our love for you to others. That's not always exciting, but it means that when that moment comes, we need to be ready to share about your love for them and for us. So help us be prepared. And this we pray in your heavenly name. Amen. One last thing. It does happen. All right, thank you. I think we have a wonderful Q&A session following worship on fishing. Let's not do that, okay? Thank you. Now, Q&A session might need to be led by somebody else. As I mentioned, fishing was not necessarily my forte, even though I enjoy it. But will you join me in a word of prayer? May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So when I say to all of y'all that you're gone fishing, what's the image that conjures up in your mind? Yeah, you can answer. On the boat in the middle of the lake. That's usually what I think of, yeah. Worms, yeah. Fishing from shore. So for some of us, it's being on the lake with our buddies and just hanging out, yeah. Boredom, all right. Boredom. Not a fan of fishing over here. For some of us, it is hanging out on a lake. For some of us, it might be standing in ankle-deep water in the beautiful mountain river, ready for that perfect catch. Some of us, it might be on a pier, smelling the salt water and listening to the waves below us. But whatever it might be, gone fishing has, in our culture, basically become synonymous with an idea of leisure. It's become synonymous with relaxation, boredom, maybe. It's that down pace that it is boredom. But it is this synonymous thing for us of leisure, vacation, rest, respite, which might not be the case for everybody, though, when we think about it. You know, I don't know if when you think about the crabbers out in the Chesapeake, if they would think about their job as being some sort of vacation. I don't know if the people that are down in Urbana dredging for oysters would think about that as some sort of respite. or the fact that there are so many fisheries out in our ocean to provide wild caught fish for people in Kansas, that this is something that would be for them relaxation. For them, it's a livelihood. For them, it's their work. It's their job. For them, they rely on it in order to live. We saw that in our own area with the blue crabs and their fluctuating numbers, that as they went down, we saw people and their livelihoods were directly affected by that. This distinction between leisure and between livelihood is important for us as we look at our scripture for this morning, looking at Jesus calling some of his first disciples. As he calls these disciples, he's walking on the lake shore. He's calls to Simon, who we know better as Peter. He calls to his brother Andrew. Later, he calls to the brothers James and John, and they are fishermen. They are out on the lake fishing. But this is not some time on the lake with the boys for these brothers. This is their job. This is their livelihood. If they don't catch fish, they don't eat. This is important to them. And this distinction makes the call story of all of these disciples even more remarkable. Because Jesus comes to these first four disciples, and he says to them, "Follow me." Essentially calling them to put aside everything, to put aside their livelihood, to put aside all that they depend on, and follow Jesus. And they do. They do. So the question that jumps out for me is why? Why do they do this? At this point of Jesus' ministry, Jesus is not well known. Jesus has not built a following yet. Jesus has not performed miracles. He has not done his public teachings. Jesus is not a known commodity in the area. He's a stranger to these people. And yet he has this invitation to follow me. And the invitation simply says, "For I will make you fishers of people." And they follow. It's truly remarkable. Because the invitation to become fishers of people, again, is not an invitation of having a flask of wine with God on the lakeshore. It's an invitation to have a vocation, an invitation to take up a livelihood with God. It's an invitation of following Jesus in a way that your whole life is surrounded and is made up by this decision to follow. It's dependent on this decision. This is an unbelievable and remarkable commitment that these four men have to make. And yet they do it. They do it. In fact, James and John, they even leave their dad in the boat and walk away to come and follow Jesus. Why? Why? You know, I wish I had the perfect answer for why. But the thing is, the scripture doesn't actually tell us. We don't have what's going on through their minds or in their hearts. We don't have a description of why these disciples decided to follow this stranger to them. All we know is what they have done. That these disciples did in fact make this commitment. They did in fact follow Jesus through town and through country, through storms on the lakeshore, through multitudes on the sides of mountains. They followed Jesus to his death, and after his death, they took up the mantle and started the church. That even some that were called on that day would die for their faith, just as Jesus died. What an amazing commitment that they took simply from the invitation to come and be fishers of people. And so it gets me thinking, maybe instead of asking the question of why did they do it, maybe the question for us should be, why do we? Why do we? Why do we accept the invitation? I mean, we as Christians know that being a Christian isn't always easy. Being a Christian is a commitment to develop our lives in a way in which we are seeking always to grow in the love of God and love of neighbor. It's a way that calls us sometimes to be in conflict with the culture and the world around us as we stand in our faith and in our morals. Being a Christian can cause us some heartache and pain sometimes. So why do we do it? Why do we do it? Why did we take that invitation and accept it? Now, the answer might be different for all of you. But when I was thinking about that this week, the answer that kept coming back to me is I accepted it because of other people who had already gone fishing before me. You know, I thought about all of these people in my life who I looked up to, who showed me the love of God through just their actions or the ways in which they influenced my life. And it was through them that I came to know God. I think first, of course, of my papa, who was a minister, a Methodist minister. And it's not the fact that he was a minister that I admired, but it's the way that he lived it out. He was a funny guy. He was a smart guy. But he was also a very principled guy. He stood up for his faith. In a time in the South of segregation, he fought for desegregation and faced backlash from it, even from the KKK and members of his own churches that he served. And it's those stories that I heard told that made me admire his faith even more. But it wasn't even just him. It was so many people that influenced my life. I think about when my parents got divorced, the place and the people that I knew that I could turn to were my friends at church. That was the community I knew that I felt safe and welcome and loved. And I think about that impact that it had on my life. And I could go on with all of these people who had already gone fishing before me. And it was their example, their love, that drew me in to say, yes, I want to do this. I want to take on this task, this commitment. And that's kind of the amazing part about this invitation to go fishing, is that we don't always know the impact that we're having. That sometimes it can feel dull and boring, as we talked about with the kids. Like fishing, sometimes it feels like we're just sitting there and waiting, and we don't know if we're having any sort of impact at all. But then when we think about our own lives, we see all of the people just through who their individual lives, just by living out their lives, have shaped us. And it makes us realize the way we live our lives matter. The way we follow Jesus matters, and it could be shaping someone's life today. Today, as we get that invitation to go fishing, it's not an invitation necessarily to do something drastic and big and crazy. It's an invitation daily to live out our lives in a manner of following Jesus, a manner of living out that love so others can see it through us. It's a commitment. It's a commitment like we take in our baptisms. That's what it is. And that's kind of a beautiful thing. Because even when we don't see the impact that we are making, we may have still influenced someone else's life. Others may have still seen Jesus through us. They may have taken that nibble. And so for us today, it's time to pack up our things and to go fishing. But it's not a leisurely trip for us. It's work. It's a vocation. It's a vocation that we have been sent on from God to share the good news with others simply by the way we live, by the way we talk about God, the way we treat one another, the way we stand on our morals. In doing this, others will come to know Christ by how we follow the Christ we know. Amen. this time, as we respond to the words that we have heard, I invite us to join in singing our next hymn. It is in the hymnal on page 344, but the words are also on the screen. The song is called, Lord, You Have Come to the Lakeshore, and I invite us to stand as you are able. So let us stand. This time, as we prepare to go to the Lord in a moment of prayer, I invite those who are worshiping with us online, you can go ahead and send in any joys or concerns that you might have that you want lifted up for prayer in the comment sections. But we will begin with those who are here in person. Are there any joys or concerns that we would like to lift up this morning? You got your expander this week, yeah? That's right. So I want to lift that up as a joy and pray for you as you work through some of the pain. Yeah. For the Caldwell family who lost their younger sister. I'm sorry, I didn't hear the... Jesus' birthday. Yeah, we celebrated Christmas just a little bit ago, and we celebrate Jesus' birthday, and we continue to celebrate Jesus, so amen.
Amen.
Yeah. keep David Simpson in our prayers. Continue to pray for Susan Roy on the death of her mom.
My friend Megan, who is recovering from breast cancer surgery.
Any others here in person that we'd like to lift up this morning? If not, do we have any online that we'd like to share?
Yes, we have one from Jen Malfair. Gratitude for professional caregivers that care for family members when we cannot. Gratitude for the snowy weather and giving us the opportunity to slow down.
All right. With those prayers lifted up, let us go to the Lord in prayer. God, we give you thanks that we can come to you, lifting up joys and concerns, celebrating as one community the fact that you have called us together, celebrating those who you have worked through to heal others, to show your love. But we also pray for those who are hurting. We pray for those who are battling cancer, those who fight horrible diseases like Alzheimer's, dementia, diabetes. We pray for those who are recovering from procedures, those who have upcoming ones, or those who are still waiting diagnoses. Have your healing hand upon them all and give them strength and their caretakers strength as well. We pray for our community. And as we enjoy the beauty of the snow around us, we give thanks for those members in our communities that have taken the efforts to keep us safe. We pray for those who are vulnerable in the bitter cold. Lord, we pray that you may use not only us as your church, but those in our community with the ability to help those who are most vulnerable at this time. And we continue to pray for all the horrible wars and battles we see overseas. We pray for Israel. We pray for Gaza. We pray for Ukraine and Russia. We pray for the crisis that we continue to see at our own border, with a solution that is not simple, but yet necessary. Lord, we lift up all these things into your hand, knowing that you are the Lord of us all. We call on you as the Prince of Peace to share your love throughout this world and to lead us as your people in reflecting that peace and love in the best ways that we can. And this we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. This time, as we gather around the communion table, I invite you to hear this invitation that Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, and who seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Now, as a people who have experienced that love and grace and peace of Christ, I invite us to share that same peace with one another. If you're online, you can share it with words like, "Peace of Christ be with you," in the comment section. If you're here in person, you can share that peace of Christ in any way you feel comfortable. But let us share the peace of Christ with one another. now as a forgiven and reconciled people, let us offer ourselves and our gifts to God. I invite ushers to come forward as we give of our tithe and of our offering. Lord, we give you thanks for these gifts. You have called us to be fishers of people. Take and use these gifts so that others may come and know your goodness, your love, your grace and mercy. And this we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. This time I invite us to join in the prayer we call the Great Thanksgiving. It can be found on your screen and also can be found in your hymnal on page 9. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. And on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, one in ministry to all the world, till Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Now with the confidence of children, let us pray as Jesus taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory forever. Amen." The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ is poured out for you. The table of our Lord is prepared. It's not my table. It's not the United Methodist Church's table. This is the Lord's table, and all are invited to come and receive the grace at the table. We'll do this by a means called intinction. All that simply means is I'll hand you a piece of bread, and you can take it and dip it into the chalice. The bread that we have is all gluten-free, and so all are invited to come and share in that. And we also have some prepackaged elements over here to the side if that is something you are more comfortable with as well. With that being said, I invite my communion assistant to come forward. And I also invite those who are members of the staff at this time who would like to receive communion to come forward. Body of Christ given for you. 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 And I invite the rest of us, as we feel called to come forward, we'll begin with this side over here. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself up for us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit, so that we may give ourselves for others. And this we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. This time, just the only announcement that I have before our benediction is just a reminder that we have wonderful opportunities for Christian education. Sunday school, just prior to worship at 9 o'clock. We have downstairs in the fellowship hall is adult Sunday school. Upstairs, we have a children's Sunday school. And then we have wonderful other opportunities throughout the week. You can look at our e-note for all the wonderful opportunities that we have. If you are not receiving our e-note and would like to, you can contact us. One of the best ways to do that is to contact our office at roundhillumc.org, and we'll get you on that weekly e-note. Again, it comes out once a week, and it is a wonderful contact list of just all the happenings of the church. And so if you're interested in that, just let us know, and we can get you on that list. With that being said, are there any other announcements that we would like to lift up? If not, then I invite you to go forth. Go fishing. Fishing for people. Knowing that the opportunity is out there, although it may not always seem as though there's biting. So go forth, not knowing when you are making an impact, but living as those who follow Jesus, knowing that in doing so, others will see Jesus through you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.